respond. The first option is to be an ostrich. Stick your head in the sand, pretend that no one is talking about these issues of gender and sexuality, and never, absolutely never talk about them in the church. Be an ostrich. The only problem is that you end up surrendering the moral and ethical imperatives of the gospel. And so I ask you, should the church abandon the realm of ethics or surrender its moral voice simply due to cultural pressures? Or is the gospel always countercultural? Second option is to be an elephant or to be a donkey. That is, you look at all the moral and ethical issues, not primarily through the lens of the Bible, but primarily through the lens of a particular political party. The only problem with that is the truism that you may have heard. What happens when you mix religion and politics? Politics. The problem with this dance is that the political party begins slowly at first, more aggressively later, to wag the tail of the Bible and the church and the church's leaders. And so the Bible eventually loses its prophetic voice. Allegiance to the Bible, sola scriptura, the great Reformation doctrine, scripture alone, begins to erode.
Amen.
You begin to find yourself becoming way more excited to live in the world of politics and to find yourself in the great story of redemption as found in the Bible. The third way, and you say, is there a third way? The third way is to be an owl, wise in wisdom, and primarily a Christian as you approach this cultural moment. So this morning I want to give you an opening framework for about how we should be talking about issues of gender and sexuality. Al said, what do you have to feed us today, Pastor? And I said, no, it's more like I'm poking and prodding today. When the title of the sermon is This Cultural Moment, you know that the pastor is poking and prodding. And so I can imagine several different ways of preaching this message today. First would be to put on my pastor counselor hat and to preach in a way that as families are dealing with these very sensitive issues, to issue some pastoral counsel advice. That would be one way. The way I've chosen this morning is to put on my pastor theologian hat and ask, how should we think about cultural engagement in today's world? And so five elements of how we should be talking about issues of gender and sexuality. Are you ready?
Yes.
Here we go. And you're like, you don't really care if we're ready, do you? I was like, no, we do not. So here we go. First word is repentance. First word is repentance. As the Big C Church, we own up to our past. Where the church has been quick to condemn and slow to listen, we repent. Where sexual sin has been raised up out of proportion to other sins, we repent. Where sexual sin has been taught to be the unforgivable sin in the church, we repent. Where slander against homosexuality or transgender people occurs in our hearts or in the heart of the church, our first word is that of repentance. Repentance is our first word in this important conversation. The second word is understanding. We want to acknowledge that a struggle is occurring, especially amongst the younger generations. Real struggles and real questions. Gender dysphoria refers to the psychological distress when someone does not identify with the biological sex of their body. And as a church, we do not want to push those struggles to the dark places of the internet, but rather be a place where these silent struggles are brought out into the light in order to experience God's healing. Third word is compassion. respond in compassionate and curious ways as we seek to point people to love and grace of God. Fourth word in this framework of how we should talk about gender and sexuality is humility. Humility. From the outset, we want to acknowledge as Christians, we are all sexually broken people. We are all sexually broken people, singles, teenagers, older people, married people, everyone in between. 1 Peter 4:17 says like this, "For it is time for judgment to begin with the household of God." So friends, it's not only the Catholic Church and its priests, its Protestants, its evangelicals. We have our Rabbi Zacharias, our Carl Linnaeus. The Southern Baptist Convention released a sad report just 3 weeks ago about the sexual abuse within the largest Protestant denomination in America. And it's all very sad. We are all sexually broken people. So the quicker we come to the table owning our brokenness, the quicker we come to the table to receive the grace of God. There's one element missing in this opening framework, and that is biblical. We simply want to ask simple questions like, what does the Bible say? What does the Bible say about gender? What does the Bible say about the new sexual revolution of LGBTQ+? Does the church still look to the Bible for its moral authority? I believe it does. Does the Bible still speak with ethical clarity regarding issues of sexuality and gender? I believe it does. And so as we have this conversation, our conversation will be humble, full of repentance, seeking understanding of one another with respectful tones, showing compassion, and standing with 2 feet solidly upon the Bible. And so what I'm really talking about today is our cultural engagement, the way we engage the culture. As Christians, how do we talk about what everyone is talking about, but in a way, and with a posture, and with a tone that no one is modeling in our larger culture? And I want to say, and what do we need to do that? What do we need to have that conversation? We need a strong community. And so I prepared this this 5-session discussion guide. We'll be talking about this in a bit more detail in the pastor study at 10. And this is what I write. I write, in this era of divisiveness, the church must model a strong community where traits like acceptance, empathy, and listening are the norm within a culture that's forgotten what those traits really mean. This community must be built on love. I'm talking about our community. Our community must be built on love, where transparent dialogue about difficult issues can legitimately take place. Truth-telling in our era is increasingly becoming difficult and even costly to personal relationships. Friends, this need not be the case in the church. Why? Because where true Christian communities practice, such conversations can strengthen relationships and sharpen the body of Christ instead of dividing it like what happens in the world. And so we know that these conversations are not happening in a healthy place in the world. If not in the church, then where? Third question is why? Why now? Why have the conversation at all? 5 elements. Again, first, relevant for our times. As a pastor, I've been here 5 years. I already know you all are talking about these issues. Right? People of all ages have asked me about these things. Literally people from 14 to 80. People in our church have written me emails, engaged me in conversations. These questions are on people's minds. Second, biblical culture with a biblical worldview. We want to be a place for a Trinity that equips you to hold and to embrace a biblical worldview in the midst of seismic cultural change. We want to be that kind of church. Third, our faith is a public faith. As Christians, we are called ambassadors. We are witnesses. And hence, we live out our faith in the public square. You see, Christians have never had a privatized faith in 2,000 years of church history, and this has never, ever been an option. Fourth, the accelerated pace of the new sexual and moral revolution. It's underfoot, and it's accelerating. Only ostriches can pretend it's not happening. You see, apologetics used to be about explaining the Christian faith to an unbelieving world. Now apologetics is also about explaining the world to the church. How do we get to the point that claims to moral truth are now embedded in emotional preferences? That's worth thinking about because it gets the very fabric of this new moral and sexual revolution. And finally, why have this conversation at all? Because God's truth always builds us up. The sermon series will not primarily be one long lament or one big polemic. We do not simply want to whine as a church about times gone by when the times were better, or when the culture was purer, or when the church was more respected. We want to engage positively with the question, what does it mean to be gender image bearers created in the very image of God? And so for the next 2 weeks after this one, there will in fact be very little polemic, because I will be talking about biblical masculinity and biblical femininity, but in ways that get beyond the typical discussion we often have about roles in the church. You and I, we should be deeply interested in asking the question, if God is a relational God, and if he created us as relational beings, male and female, then what does it mean to embrace being a deeply masculine man and a deeply feminine woman, gendered image bearers as a reflection of our relational God? That is worth thinking about. So let me give you three snapshots from the scriptures. How do we engage the Bible? And how do we engage the culture, especially in this moment where everything is political? I decry that. Many of you decry that. That's the hand that we've been dealt. Those are the cards that we hold in this era. So let me give you three examples of what not to do. Here we go. First snapshot, 8th century, Isaiah the prophet, 8th century B.C. Isaiah 61, great chapter. God says through his prophet, "For I, the Lord, love justice. Bind up the brokenhearted, liberty to the captives." Isaiah condemns the oppression of the foreigner, the oppression of the poor, the oppression of the marginalized, full stop. And you, if you lay down over this text a modern American political binary, you might say, "Oh, that sounds progressive, Isaiah the prophet. That sounds like social justice." No, my friends, it is biblical justice, and it is a huge category of the prophets. Do not lay a modern American political binary over the Bible. Second snapshot, fast forward to the first century. A conversation occurred between Jesus and Nicodemus, John chapter 3. Jesus tells Nicodemus, "You must be born again." And if you lay a modern American political binary over this text, you might be tempted to say, "Well, does that mean Jesus supports majority of the late 20th century, that sounds very conservative. No, it's simply the doctrine of regeneration, a huge category of biblical salvation. Do not lay a modern American political binary over the texts of Scripture. You will always muzzle the Scriptures if you do. Fast forward to the late first century to the Apostle Paul. Galatians 3:28. Paul writes, "There is neither Jew nor Greek, there is neither slave nor free, there is neither male nor female, for you are all one in Christ Jesus." And someone might say, is Paul saying that there must be racial unity in the body of Christ because Christ's salvation has come for all? That sounds rather progressive. Paul must be in my camp. But then I would turn to Romans chapter 1, where Paul, the apostle, equally inspired by God, equally writing the words of God, says this: "For the women exchange natural relations for those that are contrary to nature. And men likewise are consumed with passion for one another, receiving in themselves a due penalty for their error. God gave them up to a debased mind to do what ought not to be done." Are you saying Paul considers homosexuality a sin? That sounds conservative. Paul must be in my camp. And so when I say to you what I've often said before, we are not a red church. We are not a blue church. We are a Jesus church. What I'm also really saying to you is this: you have to give up reading the Bible through a very narrow and a recently modern and a uniquely American political binary, right and left, Republican and Democrat, red and blue. Because if you do not give up reading the Bible this way and living out the faith this way, then you are falling into the trap of political idolatry. Because every time you put politics over the Bible, political idolatry. Every time you put politics over the faith, you are a political idolatry. And this political idolatry in our era is happening on both the right and the left. Let me further illustrate this point by asking the rather controversial and polemical question: was Jesus a Democrat or a Republican? And you say, "Pastor, didn't you just tell us not to transpose a very narrow and a recently modern and a uniquely American political binary over the Bible? Then why should we do that to Jesus?" And I would say to you, very good point. But at the very same time, Jesus lived and moved in the first century of Palestine that was rife with political controversies. And these political factions in Jesus' day were just as contentious, if not more so, and just as divisive, if not more so, than our modern cultural moment. And so there were, by my count, six distinct political parties in Jesus' day. You think two warring factions is bad, you haven't seen nothing yet. And so, here they are. First, the Sadducees. They were the wealthy landowning elites who controlled the temple. The priests and the high priests typically came from the Sadducees. The Pharisees were a middle-class movement, very popular with the masses, who sought to be the arbiters of Old Testament law. The Essenes were the third party who believed that the Jewish government was hopelessly and irredeemably corrupt, and eventually withdrew into the wilderness to wait for the end of the world. Don't you sometimes want to be an Essene? The community at Qumran produced the Dead Sea Scrolls were Essenes. Fourth party were the Zealots. Now the Zealots were a lot like the Pharisees religiously, but they were nationalists who resisted Roman rule even to the point of armed insurrection, as embodied by the Maccabees, who sought to overthrow Roman rule with violence. Herodians were a political party that owed its authority from King Herod, favored Greek customs, and, unlike the Zealots, were committed to maintaining the peace and the status quo, law and order, under Herodian rule. Sixth party were the scribes. These were the lawyers and teachers under the jurisdiction of the Sanhedrin, which was a Jewish council controlled by the Sadducees. And so I ask you a very important question. Which political party captured Jesus' heart in the first century? To what political party did Jesus regularly write blank checks of affection? When did Jesus put obedience to the scriptures lower than his political inclinations? Answer, never. Rather, he blasted the Sadducees for not believing in the resurrection, for lining their own pockets at the expense of the poor. When Jesus went and overturned the money changers at the temple, it would have been the Sadducees who suffered financial loss on that day. He blasted the Pharisees and the scribes for being hypocrites. You brood of vipers, you lay heavy burdens on all the people that you yourself can never fulfill. He blasted the Herodians. Publicly, everyone knew that Herod and John the Baptist were mired in controversy. John the Baptist had called out Herod for unlawfully taking his sister-in-law after divorcing his first wife. So Jesus weighs in. Among those born of women, there has not risen anyone greater than John the Baptist. Controversial? You bet. He blasted the Zealots and their nationalistic aspirations. Turn the other cheek. Peter, put away your sword. The kingdom of God is at hand, but it never comes about through violence. He blasted the Essenes. He didn't really, because they don't even hear the gospel. Don't you see it in your waistcoat? But Jesus did say things like, you are the light of the world. You are the salt of the earth. Jesus sent his disciples into the world not to withdraw into the wilderness at Qumran. And so even from the ministry and life of Jesus, we have Jesus opposing wealthy landowning elites. We have Jesus opposing middle-class populism. We have Jesus opposing nationalistic and armed insurrectionists. And Jesus equally opposing those who settle for a peaceful and law and order status quo. Jesus did not fit into any of the major political parties of his day. And so I ask you, what does that tell you about this cultural moment? It requires you to think carefully, to think biblically, and to think in ways that are Jesus-centered as we respond to the culture. How do we enter the public square? How do we do cultural engagement? Scriptures as our authority, Jesus as our guide, meekness as our posture, compassion as our cornerstone, as we minister to all people, all created in the image of God. Can I say that again? Scriptures as our authority, Jesus as our guide, meekness as our posture, compassion as our cornerstone, as we minister to people, all created in the image of God. Now, this is not to say that Christians should withdraw from the public square. This is not to say that Christians should abandon addressing issues of ethics and morality in our society. Jesus himself debated issues in the public square. This is not to say that Christians cannot come to firm conclusions about a particular form of government, big government or small government, what best serves the interests of society. It is, however, to warn us that as Christians, we should not have politics wagging the tail of following Jesus. with the political divisiveness of his day. Well, now let's go from Jesus to the early church. How did the early church go from 11 apostles and Paul to conquering culturally, socially, and ethnically virtually the entire Mediterranean world? This transformation happened within a Roman Empire that was hostile to Christianity, that persecuted Christianity, and propagated moral and sexual ethics that were vastly different than the church. Dr. Larry Hurtado, one of the foremost scholars of Christian origins in the early church, distinguished professor at the University of Edinburgh, spent much of his academic career in Europe, identifies five key features of the early church that were curiously and interestingly enough, both supremely attractive to the Roman world and deeply countercultural all at the same time. Moderns think that relevance makes Christianity attractive. What the early church experienced was that being countercultural, especially over and against a culture that was deeply flawed and deeply fallen, was itself supremely attractive. So for the first 400 years of its existence, this is not a small snapshot. This is four centuries. Five unique features gave the early church such a solid identity that the Roman world was wooed and wowed by Christ. What were they? First, the early church was a multiracial and multi-ethnic community, experiencing a unity across ethnic boundaries that was startling and surprising. Acts chapter 13 says like this, "And there were in the church of Antioch prophets and teachers, Barnabas and Simon, who was called Niger, Lucius of Cyrene, Manny, a lifelong friend of Herod the Tetrarch, and Saul." So here you have Barnabas of Jewish background, Simeon from Niger country adjacent to the African Niger River, probably black, Lucius of Cyrene, who was from North Africa, west of Egypt, Manion, who was the foster brother of Herod the Tetrarch, who beheaded John the Baptist. Not only Jews and Gentiles, but different cultures, different classes, different linguistic backgrounds, all ministering together. Friends, this was astonishing because it presented a radical challenge to the entrenched social structure and divisions of Roman society. Countercultural, and yet so attractive to so many. Second, identifying feature, the early church was highly committed to care for the poor and marginalized by practicing hospitality. The Roman world expected you to care for your own family and from your own tribe. Yet Christians were countercultural in that they helped everyone. They practiced justice everywhere. During the urban plagues of the 2nd and 3rd centuries, Christians stood out. One 2nd century plague lasted 19 years and killed 5 million people. The Bishop of Alexandria wrote this about Christians in the 3rd century. He says, "Most of our brother Christians showed unbounded love and loyalty, never sparing themselves. Heedless of the danger, they took charge of the sick, attending to their every need, and ministering to them in Christ, and with them departed this life serenely happy, for they were infected by others with the disease, drawing on themselves the sickness of their neighbors, and cheerfully accepting their pain." When Romans fled cities, Christians stayed. Christians cared. Christians showed compassion to all the poor, all the suffering, to all the diseased. Friends, it was a hospitality that won over the Roman world. Third, the early church lived out a strong sexual counterculture over and against widely acceptable sexual practices of the Roman Empire. What were those practices? Prostitution was ubiquitous and uncontroversial. The sexual exploitation of poor women and enslaved women was abetted by public institutions. Slaves, prostitutes, and children, meaning boys, were viewed as perfectly legitimate outlets for the sexual male desire. If a man slept with prostitutes before marriage, he was still counted as a virgin. If during marriage, it was not considered adultery. One Christian bishop described Roman sexual policy as, quote, forbidding adulteries, building brothels. This Christian sexual ethic was radically countercultural then, as it is now. Who were the winners of this Christian cultural revolution in the first few centuries? Women, slaves, prostitutes, and young boys were all the big winners of a Christian sexual counterculture that was so attractive to so many. You see, when the early church insisted and kept insisting that sex was reserved exclusively for marriage between one man and one woman, it was completely subversive and yet completely liberating because it was good and true and beautiful and according to God's design. Fourth unique feature of the early church. The early church was a community strongly committed to the sacred nature of life and the protection of children against infanticide and abortion. The early church prioritized children. The early church rescued abandoned children. The early church placed children in Christian homes, including some with disabilities caused by unsuccessful abortions. According to the 12 tables of the Roman law, quote, deformed infants shall be killed. Infanticide. Our own son Tristan would have been killed under Roman law. The widely circulated didache, the teaching of the 12 apostles, which was widely used in the early church as a catechism all over the Mediterranean world, spoke directly against these Roman practices. In sum, the church embodied a countercultural ethic against widely accepted practices backed by Roman law. Fifth, the early church was a peacemaking community committed to practicing forgiveness, peacemaking, and a non-retaliatory posture. MLK and the civil rights movement has roots going all the way back to the early church. And so it was these five identifying features all together that revolutionized and transformed the entire Roman Empire for the cause of Christ. Now, I've just run through very quickly, 4 centuries, 400 years of the early church, countercultural in 5 major ways. And some of you, I know what you were doing. Even though I just warned you against it, what were you doing? You were laying a modern American political binary over these issues. That is, you agreed with this one, you disagreed with that one. You supported this one, but you were suspicious of that one. Why? Because the first two sound progressive. The third and the fourth sound conservative. The fifth, it doesn't easily fall into the binary. And so imagine with me a scenario for a moment. Imagine me preaching in Birmingham, Alabama, in the Deep South, as a guest preacher one day. And the pastor there gives me the text. Galatians 3:28. Neither Jew or Gentile, we are all one in Christ Jesus. And as an illustration, I point to tenet number one of the early church, namely, that the early church was a multiracial and multi-ethnic community experiencing unity across ethnic boundaries that was startling and astonishing and so attractive to so many because it went against the structured divisions of Roman society. And after the church service, some say to me, Pastor, you're capitulating to woke ideology from the woke crowd. You are hopelessly progressive. Why? Because they are into shallow. American political binary. Their pastor, perhaps, never challenged them and never warned them about political idolatry, so they engage in it. Yet imagine with me another occasion. I'm preaching for a friend in New York City. They're going through the great book of Romans, and he just happens to schedule a vacation right where Paul addresses the issue of homosexuality, because he's a coward. And he's never challenged and warned his people not to interpret the scriptures through the modern American political binary. And so I preach Paul in the way that Paul has been interpreted and preached for 2,000 years. In the same way that the churches in Asia, Latin America, and Africa, these regions where Christianity is exploding, I preach the text in that same way, staying with all these nationalities, all these ethnicities within the global church. And what happens after the service? Well, I'm called narrow, judgmental, bigoted, and hopelessly conservative. What is going on? You can get called a bigot for championing racial unity in the Deep South, and you can get called a bigot for championing the historic Christian sexual ethic in the urban centers of our country. Friends, there's always an offense to the gospel. The ethics downstream from the cross is always offensive. Now, all that was introduction to Genesis chapter 1. Made in the image of God, what I call the Genesis blueprint. First, God defines what he designed. Genesis paints a beautiful picture of creation, with creation of male and female as the finishing masterpieces on an extraordinary design, made with extra care, extra attention, extra precision, male and female, made in the image of God. And so just as a plane's engine cannot independently decide to be a wheel because the engine has been designed for a specific purpose, so too it is God who defines what he designs. That's the Genesis blueprint. Second point of the Genesis blueprint. Your body is you, and you are your body. And curiously, this is the opposite of how we tend to think. Genesis 2:7. Then the Lord God formed a man from the dust of the ground and breathed into his nostrils the breath of life. And the man became a living being. We tend to think that God made his soul. The soul floats around in the heavens or in the universe for a while, and then later God gives you a body. And so if you've ever heard anyone say, "You are my angel sent down from heaven. You came down from heaven to be my little child," that's really not good. Because the first thing God does is make a body, and then he brings life to it. Someone once said, we are an animated body, not an incarnated soul. That's very helpful. We are not a soul who happens to simply have a body. Neither are we a body with a soul. Paul Truman says this, there is no I without the body. There is no us that exists independently of our flesh, which is then randomly assigned to the bodies we have. No, your body is you, and you are your body. God defines what he designs. Your body is an integral part of you, and no one discards it to find an inner person that exists apart from the body. Third, the Genesis blueprint, we are gendered image bearers blessed by God. God blesses male. God blesses female. God gives them to one another. Imagine a world where male and female are completely at ease with who they are, how they're made, and all the various particularities of their body. feminine women for the glory of God. And all that entails, in ways that go beyond stereotypes, is what we're going to talk about in the next 2 weeks. Let's go down prayer. Father, this cultural moment often leaves our heads spinning. And yet, we plant here at Trinity 2 feet solidly upon your word. Pray for our discussion, Lord, that we would be a strong enough community where empathy and acceptance and love are built into the fabric of who we are. Father, we come together to engage, and now we come together in unity to the table of our Lord Jesus Christ. Be with us.